we stopped last time by completing the XML. As you remember, in the very beginning of the last class, I discussed that we need to cover XML means you need to have an idea of what is XSL and what is XSV and XPath also. XPath is not major component, but if you want to learn the XSL, XSL is based on XPath. So we got to cover that also. So today we are going to start with XSL. So basically, XSL actually consists of XSLT, XPath, and some vocabulary. So XSL stands for Extensible Style Sheet Language. Basically, we use XSL to convert some XML document basically to HTML format, or you can do it in other ways also. So basically, if I want to give you an idea, so this is your XML file, and we need to create a HTML file from this XML. So basically, XML will consist of the data of what you need to display in some format. Here we are talking about displaying in HTML format. So maybe here, as we discussed last time, we have the menu, like the code, and several codes. Okay, this is the file that I'm talking about, is the file that we discussed in last time, the XML file. So I want to display these things in here as a table. Let's say I have five food, and each food will have the price and description, calories, and all these attributes. So I want to display this thing as a table where you have name, price, and description. But with this XML format, I cannot, basically it's just contain the data. I want to display that. It's like this. The solution is use XSL file, define your XSL, and attach this XSL file to XML, so that once you open this XML file from a browser, it will understand that the data in the XML document should be displayed in this format. That is the main usage of XSL. So XSL is the major thing which consists of XSLT, the transformations. This file will be written in XSLT, which is the language. Okay. And XPath is how you... So I have to tell here, food element should be displayed in this format, and name, which is under food, and price, like that. So I have to somehow refer to these elements. So there is a standard format of referring this element called XPath. We will go through some examples. So that is why XPath is very relevant to XSLT. And then in this language, they have set of elements, predefined elements, so that any browser, so if somebody has to develop a software to interpret these two, the combination of XML and XSL, there should be some agreement saying that these are the terms that is going to be used in this language, and this is how you gonna display this, like in Java.
It's basically, XSL is a spreadsheet that's used to input and organize information to the XML. Or am I confused here?
It's not a spreadsheet. It's okay. You will understand this thing in a few minutes because I'll go through the examples. So today, whatever I teach here, I will explain with examples. So, like in Java, you have these keywords, right? Like class, public, private, and all those things. So somebody, if somebody want to write a compiler to Java, he needs to understand what these terms means. Otherwise, if you just use ad hoc terms, nobody can write a software. So likewise, here, this language has a set of terminologies. The SSL consists of that vocabulary, so that somebody can write a piece of software to interpret these things and display it in the format that that the user wants. So those are the three components of XSL. Okay, so we are going to start with XPath. Basically, XPath is to navigate through the XML elements. You can say, I need this element, I need this attribute. Likewise, as you in the previous lecture, we covered XML parsers, where you wrote a Java program to get all this data. Basically, so here we are talking about converting some XML file to another format. Okay? So we are not taking the data out of this XML and put it into another program as an input. We just need to display it like this. So this XPath, we can use the language of XPath and get the data out of these elements. Okay? So, and this is a W3C recommendation. So here are a few examples. Okay? Let's say you have a file like this. Okay, you have a file not inside not you have body and then from and from has attribute source. So this is our XML file that we are going to write some XPath queries and to get some data out of this XML document. Okay. So here you have bookstore as the root element and it has several book elements. Inside each book has an attribute called category and each book element will have like four elements, title, author, year and price. And title has a attribute for language. So I want to get all the titles of the books. Actually, to do this kind of thing, you need to know something called JavaScript, which is a client-side language for browsers. So, in this lecture, we are not going to cover the JavaScript, but JavaScript. So, we will be covering JavaScript in the future lecture, one of the future lecture. So, let's say I want to get all the titles. So you can see here, bookstore, which is the root element, and book, okay, which is the child element of bookstore, and then each book will have title. So now, if I run this thing, it will give you all the titles of the books. Okay. So let's say I want to get this attribute, the language attribute of each book element. So title has an attribute called language. So I can basically say I have language till title, and then I know that title has attribute called lang, and I just say add sign and lang. So it will give you all the attributes. This X part is much more advanced than this. We can have filters like the following. Okay, before that, let's see here, since it has four book elements, whenever I say this, it will give you all the lang attributes of four elements. If I want to just pick this, I would say, give me the first. Okay. First type. Likewise, I can access the particular positions of this array. And then I can do something like here you can see in the XML document, each book has a element or price, which has some double value, and also year. So let's say I want to get all the books which is the price of the book is greater than 35. So I can basically write something like this, and whenever you say book here. Knows that these are the elements that this guy is referring to, and how to display this. So as we discussed these things, XSLT is the transformation language, which has particular set of vocabulary like elements, predefined elements, so you can use this.
So XSLT is just a way to convert XML to other forms of format like Java,
yes.
Or
not Java. You can convert it to text formats.
Ah.
Okay.
And XPath is basically the means to the end.
Yes, XSLT is based on XPath. So here you have to have a way to say that these are the elements that I'm referring to interpret in some other format. XPath is the way to do that. Okay, so here are a few tags from XSLT. All these are predefined things. Okay. Almost all these things are self-registered. So here, this is a loop. Okay, you know Java has this kind of thing, and this is the sort. If choose is almost same to switch statements, and when is almost like the if. Like that, they have this particular vocabulary, so that you can use these things and convert the XML. Let's see how to do that. XML here, that means we are telling to the XSL document that this is your XML document. we are doing it in the other way. Okay? If you look at this XML document, you can see here, I'm saying to the XML document that this is your SSL document. Because XML, is that this is the file that is being displayed in the browser, not the SSL file. So, now, you guys are familiar with this TR and TD tags. So, for one row, what I'm saying is, get the value of this element. This is the X part, the breakfast, the menu, food and name, and put it in one this cell. And the second cell should consist of the price of the element. So if I now the XML document is displayed in browser. Have a look here. For each element of breakfast, menu, and food, I want to get all the things. Now, since I have already referred to breakfast/food, here I can just say name and price. I don't need to do this again. Test for if the price is greater than, okay, you cannot use is greater than sign because it's already it's a symbol of the language itself. So what I'm saying is, if the price element is greater than 5, please put it into the table. Otherwise, just ignore. So you can have this kind of sophisticated speech in the XSL file. And so here you can see now you have this thing, which is less than 5. And if I guess that thing. Things from the XML document, and you can have all these styles like your table, colors, and all these things, and you can attach CSS to these things and display it in HTML. That's the main use of XSL.
If you are dealing with this
all systems, then you have to deal with DDD, because once you define a schema for a big XML file, it's very difficult to change that. You have to go through each and every line and kind of SSD, and they don't feel it, they don't feel the necessity of doing that for some systems. So here we are going to use XSD for define the schema for XML documents. So with XML XSD documents, XSD files, you can define for each XML document, these are the elements that appear in XML documents, and this is the order that things should appear. Okay, these are the child element of this element, and this is the data type, and these are the attributes that can present in the this element, whether the attribute is required or it is optional, and all these kind of rules. The main reason to use XSD files is to, since the XML has this freedom of defining all these tags as I wish. If I am to communicate with somebody else, it's very difficult to have the agreement between two parties. The only way to do that is define the schema that, okay, this is the format, you should send me the message. These are the element that should appear. This is the order that they should appear. These are the attributes and all those things you can define. If, let's say, if I send the document and the other party can validate the XML document with the XSD file. If it fails, that means my XML XML document is not tied to that XSD scheme. So that is the main reason to use the XSD. So as I said that we had something called DDD. So what is the difference between XSD and DDD? So XSD basically based on XML documents, you don't have to learn any other language to do the things. If you are comfortable with XML, it's just a matter of learning few terms from XSD to define your scheme. And DDD actually not support data types. So that in DDD I cannot say this element should contain only string, this element should contain only data, only integer value, like that. So with XSD you can do that, and furthermore, like from XSD you can define your own data types. Okay. So that is the main advantages of XSD. So these are the few data types from XSD. Here you can see it covers almost all required data types. Basically you will deal with strings, decimal, and integer, maybe date and time. So with all these six elements, you should be able to write almost all your XML files except if you have a particular requirement. In that case, you can define your own data types. So you know that in XML we use this term called element to define all these, to refer all these tags. In XSD, they distinguish between two types of tags. Simple types means something like this. Likewise, we had the name of our code. So simple types can have only text, which is the value. This can be integer, double, or whatever it is, but it can only have some value. So the value surrounded by text means simple types. So complex types, it's like this, and they have these four things: empty elements, image and maybe source. Okay, but you don't have any data. So I think you guys are familiar with this kind of thing. These things appear in the HTML also. And element can contain other elements, which means that should be a complex type, which is like this. We have this thing. So here, foot is a complex type because it contains other elements. Elements contain, okay, here the next one is like our price. It has something called price, which had a unit. So here, since it has attribute, this becomes under complex type. The difference between this and this one is only the attribute. And you can have mixed things, like each element can have text plus elements. So those things will become again complex type. So they have a different vocabulary to define the simple type element and the complex type element. Let's do the demo of SSL. Okay, here again we are going to use the cell file. Which is the menu file where you have multiple foot elements and each foot element has a pixel tags. So let's define a schema for this one, saying that it should start with breakfast menu and it should have food as child elements of the breakfast, and food should have all these four five things. And then I can say price can only contain double value, okay? And it should have an attribute, okay? And then I can say calories should contain only integer, and all these are strings. So let's try to define these things, okay? This is an HSD file for the same XML document. Don't worry, once you do the assignment of this particular task, you will get familiar with all these things. You just need some hands-on experience to understand this. So if you don't understand 100% with all these elements, what each and everything means, don't worry, you will be very comfortable. So here, we start with traditionally, since this is again XML document, we have our processing instruction, okay. And here I'm defining the namespace for each and every element here. So this is the vocabulary, it has element. It has all these are standard terms for the HSD. HS means the namespace. Okay. So the only reason to have this thing is somebody else can define the element tag called element in the XML file, and there's no way to distinguish between that element and this element. So that is why, as I described in the previous lecture, that is why we are using the namespaces. So we are start with this is the root element of this class, this of this document, the schema. What we should do is, when we see an element in the XML document, okay, we should write the schema definition for that element. Okay. So our first one is breakfast menu, which is the first element that we came across in the XML document. You can see breakfast menu contains other elements. Okay. That means it becomes a complex type. We should define the breakfast menu as a complex tag, okay, which contains other tags. So, this is the definition. Definition of breakfast menu. It is an element, but it is a complex type. And then I am saying that it can contain sequence of element called food, okay? And the number of occurrences of food element is unbounded. So you can have as many as food elements inside the breakfast menu. You can have restrictions on here, like it should be 5 only, maximum it should be 5, and you can have the min occurs also. Likewise, they have this vocabulary so that you can have all these kind of restrictions to define your schema. So here, what you should understand here is, we started with breakfast menu, which is a complex type. We are in fact, which is that breakfast menu is a complex type and we define it accordingly. Here, I'm not defining the food, I'm just referring to the something on the food element. So let's see how we define the food element. Before that, let's see how food element looks like. So it also has all these other elements. Again, food element becomes complex type. Okay. So here is my food element, which is again a complex type. Okay. Here I am saying it consists of sequence of all these things: name, price, description, calories, and the date. All our elements from the XML document. And all these things should appear in this sequence.
Cannot appear in
other
order.
No. That's why I'm saying
it should follow the strict order that the food must have first name, then price, and description. It should not have price and then.
No, that's why the sequence means that. Okay. So, here again I'm referring to some other elements which is defining somewhere else in the file. Because I don't want to have the everything in one. So I will show you the file which has everything inside one element, which is kind of, it's not readable. Okay. It's really difficult to understand if you're looking at looking into the files at the first time. So here we again should understand what is a complex type and it has sequence of all these things. Okay. And then, if we go to our file again, we define this one, okay, breakfast menu, and we already defined the food also. The next one is the name. We don't have defined the food file address. You guys understand that, because we only deal with one. Schema means you define the general thing. You don't have, say, each and every thing. Food means one. You can have multiple instances in the XML document, that doesn't matter. So next one is the name. So here you can see name is just a simple type. It does not have attribute, it does not have elements inside that. It just has only the text. So go to the document again. Here is the name, which is the simple type. And I'm saying that inside the name, you can have only strings. And what is our next step is the price, which is again a complex type because it has data plus attribute. Okay, that is the only difference between this one and that one to price to become a complex type. How do I define the price? It's like this. Okay. I have the element price, which is a complex type. Okay. And then since it has this attribute, I'm defining like it has in the language itself, it has this simple content. Even though it's a complex type, it is not complex as other things. You just have the text and the attribute. Okay. Here I'm saying it should contain decimal. Okay. And it has attribute called currency. The value of currency should be a string, okay? And it is a required. It is not optional. Each and every price tag should have attribute for currency. It should have a value of type string. Okay? You can actually have all the possible. Let's say you are restricted to five kind of currencies like USD, Euro, or all these kind of things. If you have that set of five things defined, you can say here only you can have all. One of these values. Okay. We have some example down here. So you can have restrictions like that. Okay. Now let's get back to the XML file. We are here. We have defined all these tags. Now next one is the description, which is again a simple type. Here is the description, because it's a simple type, it's very simple in the HSD document also. And calories, it is again a simple type, you just have H. And you can have, I think, find it. Here, the calories. Is a simple type. The interesting thing is the next one, which is our day. So day here, I just included this thing to demonstrate the other construct of the XSD language. Basically, think about like this is the special food for Monday. It's the special, all these things has a special thing put in Monday, right? So here, let's say this is the special for Monday, this is special for Tuesday kind of thing. So this is how I define the data. Okay. So it is actually not a complex type, it just has some text only. But text you can define like these are the only possible values you can have in the that text. That's why I have this restriction, which is a string only, but that string should come from this five values only. Okay, you can't have any other. Likewise, you can do the same thing for the attribute, the currency should be USD, Euro, or whatever it is. So now, let's say I have the schema defined, and I have the XML, and I have like in the HSL way, maybe I have to say that XML, to the XML file that this is your HSD file. Here I'm saying that, okay, XSL, this is your XSD file. So now, if you define this file. Let's say you have some string here. Instead of the double value, browser will not compare. We have a specific software, it's a software called XML validators. Okay? You can use these softwares to validate your XML document against XSplit. So I found one online here. Here you need to paste the XML and the next part is the XSD. Okay, before that, let's see if you define your XSD as a one tag, how it looks like. Okay, here you can see in this file I have defined all these tags separately, where you have the breakfast menu, the game food, day, price, and all these things separate. Okay. If you define all these things together, the file should look like this. Not a friendly version of that. But basically, it has the same information, like you start from breakfast menu and you say it's a complex type and it has the sequence, and the other one is the food, which is again a complex type, and all these things. The semantics of the this thing and that thing is the same, but yeah, it's very difficult to understand. Yeah. It's difficult to me to explain the file. So here you can see this validator has three components. You can test for the well-formness of the XML document, you can test for the validity of XSD document, and you can test for the validity of XML documents against the XSD. see what are reasons like paste the XML document and paste the SSD schema and ask to validate. And it said me it's a valid document. Let's change some stuff here. Let's see, I make it string. And then it will say price element has invalid value according to the date type, according to its data. Likewise, you can validate your assignment for 3-4 minutes and let's see if you guys understand what you are supposed to do.